In this video, you will see in action one of the 23 classical design patterns introduced by Gang of Four, and besides the pattern itself, I will show you how it was applied in order to build Angular Forms package. If you are first time on my channel, my name is Dmytro Mrzhensky, and here you can find a lot of advanced Angular tutorials that you can check out later. But for now, let's get started and figure out which design pattern makes Angular Forms possible. First of all, let's quickly recap what types of Angular Forms exist, because it is quite important puzzle in the final picture. And in addition to that, it will be a good refresher for those who just started with Angular or for those who didn't work with it for a while. So in Angular, there are two approaches to working with forms: the reactive approach and template-driven one. To work with reactive forms, you have to import the reactive forms module, then create an instance of the form control model that is going to represent the state of the form control, right? And finally, you have to bind this model with some native form control like text input, and you can do that by using form control directive that is being exported from the reactive forms module. After that, the model state will be always in sync with the state of the native control. The same functionality we can achieve using template-driven forms. For that, you have to import the model forms module. Then you have to create a class property, and then using the ng-model directive and two-way data binding, you can achieve the same value synchronization between the native form control and the class property. And that's it. You don't need to create form control model explicitly, because the ng-model directive will create it under the hood. To implement this synchronization between native form control and corresponding model, Angular uses such a thing called value access, which might be known for some of you who already tried to implement custom form controls. These value accessor and directives you have seen are parts of bridge design pattern implementation. So yes, today we're gonna talk about design pattern called bridge, and we will have a look how it was applied in Angular Forms. But before we move on, I would like to ask you one simple question. Do you want to become a real expert in Angular Forms? If so, I would like to recommend my recent video course dedicated to advanced concepts of Angular Forms. And there, besides the basic things like template-driven forms or reactive forms, we will do a lot of source code investigations, so you will understand in depth how Angular Forms are working. And at the end of the course, you will be able to build really complex custom form controls, like custom drop-down component that supports multi-selection, option searching, or accessible navigation through the options and selecting them just by pressing enter on your keyboard. And additionally, you will learn how to create forms dynamically from some JSON config, which appropriate architecture to choose for that, and how to optimize it by lazily load dynamic controls. This everything you will learn from the course. Links will be in the video description. Okay, now let's get back to the topic. And before we dive into the source code of Angular Forms and start to investigate the implementation of value accessor, I think it is a good idea to learn more about bridge design pattern without Angular context and figure out what problem solves this pattern. If you try to Google this pattern, most probably you will find the definition like: bridge is a design pattern used in software engineering that is meant to decouple an abstraction from its implementation so that the two can vary independently. And also, there you can find a UML diagram like this, which is hard for understanding, not only for beginners, but also for experienced developers. So let's try to figure out what is actually hidden behind all these scary and smart words and diagrams. So firstly, I would suggest figuring out what means abstraction in the context of the bridge pattern. So abstraction is a high-level control layer for some entities. In simple words, it is just a simple class. And this high-level class isn't supposed to do any real work on its own. It should delegate the work to the implementation layer. And again, in simple words, the implementation layer is just another class that contains the concrete logic. But the easiest way to catch it up is to see how it looks in real code, right? So let's do that. And here you can see the following layout of my VS Code, where you can see a section for abstractions, implementations, and playground. The playground, this is the place where those both abstractions and implementation will be combined. And now let's imagine that I have to design a payment system that needs to support multiple types of payments, like one-time payment and subscription payment, and it should support many payment providers like PayPal, Apple Pay, credit cards, etc. And all these things needs to be scalable and compatible with each other. I mean, payments and payments providers. And it is a perfect use case for the bridge pattern. So first, let's try to define entities that are considered to be abstractions and which are implementations. According to the definition above, I think a good candidate for the abstraction could be a payment, which might be described by a simple class that has some method like pay. And here, pay attention that to be an abstraction, not necessary, it must be an abstract class or interface. It might be anything that doesn't contain implementation details. Okay, but if the payment is an abstraction, what would be implementation in this case? If I place the logic here inside the pay method, it will not be abstraction anymore because it contains all the implementation logic. So what are we gonna do? Well, we can represent implementation as a separate class called, let's say, PayPal provider, and place the implementation details in a separate method like execPayment, where the concrete API is called and the appropriate logic will be executed. Then, using the class aggregation, the abstraction layer can get reference to the implementation class instance that it will receive via the class constructor and store it in the corresponding property, which eventually plays the role of the bridge between abstraction and implementation. Then, since it has a reference to the concrete implementation, now the payment class can delegate payment logic to some concrete payment provider. So now in the playground.ts file, we can simply create an instance of the payment class and provide an instance of the concrete provider and then safely execute the payment. However, currently we have quite a serious limitation. Our abstraction class depends on a concrete implementation like PayPal provider. So if I want to introduce a new payment provider, let's say Apple Pay, it will be problematic even though they both have exact payment methods. This is a pure violation of the dependency inversion design principle, which says that high-level modules should not depend on low-level modules. Both should depend on abstraction. So it means that instead of depending on the PayPal provider, it is better to rely on something that doesn't have concrete implementation, but rather just describes the set of methods that needs to have each payment provider. An interface is a great option for that. So let's create one, and in our case, this interface will have only one exact payment method. And then all other providers should implement this interface to be seamlessly interchangeable for the payment class. And in such a way, I can introduce as many new providers as I need without modifying the payment class and already existing providers. So this is the first part of bridge pattern, which, by the way, might look like a strategy pattern, and indeed in some aspects they might be very similar. However, unlike strategy pattern, the bridge supposes that the abstraction layer class hierarchy can scale as well, staying compatible with all existing payment providers. And the abstraction class hierarchy can be scaled either by just extending the current payment class, or what you can also see quite often is that the root of the hierarchy is an abstract class that hosts our bridge between the abstraction and implementation hierarchies, and it could contain maybe some common logic, methods, or properties. And then different types of payment just extend it and bring their own functionality that makes sense only for this type of payment. For example, the subscription payment could extend the pay method of the base class, and additionally it can set the date of the next payment, so you could have something like that. But because of the inherited bridge, these new payment types stay compatible with all existing and future payment providers, and all payment providers will stay compatible with all existing and future payment types. So it allows you to scale independently both hierarchies, abstractions, and implementations without modifying already existing classes. So this is the general idea of the bridge design pattern, and now let's have a look how it was applied in Angular Forms package. So firstly, let me quickly show you that Form control and ng-model directives, they don't reside alone on their nodes. If we try to have a look at this node in Angular DevTools, we can see that besides the ng-model directive, there is also some default value accessor directive. And the same story you can see also for the form control directive, and you can see it right here. This default value accessor directive was magically applied to this input because every input which is not a checkbox and has an attribute ng-model form control or form control name applied is actually a valid selector for this directive, which is exactly our case. What is also interesting is that if we introduce a new type of native control like checkbox, then instead of default value accessor, you will see the checkbox control value accessor. And if the ng-model is attached to the select element, then you will see the select control value accessor directive attached. All that accessors have a common goal, which is synchronization of the native control state with the corresponding form control model. This state synchronization happens using four methods that have every control accessor directive. Those are write value, register on change, register untouched, and set disabled state methods. These methods are described by the control value accessor interface, which implements each of these directives. However, the implementation, the logic of these four methods is different for every control accessor because different native controls have different APIs, and that's why every native control type has a corresponding value accessor that can work exactly with this native control. So we can easily recognize that in the context of the bridge pattern, the control accessors and the control value accessor interface, they represent the implementation hierarchy, right? But what about the abstraction layer? What represents this part? Well, the abstraction layer is represented by directives we all perfectly know. For reactive forms, those are form control and form control name directives, and for template driven ones, it is the ng model directive. If you check their source code, you can see that they all extend a common class called ng control, and if you jump there, you can find the property called value accessor, which is exactly our bridge between abstraction and implementation layers. The concrete implementation of the control accessor happens in constructors of the derived directives. And using dependency injection, Angular injects the instance of the value accessor directive, which resides on the same node with this directive, and then it assigns the instance of the value accessor directive to the value accessor property. And once the value accessor is resolved, it is used when the form control model is being set up. If you follow this call chain and jump right into the setup control function, you can see how the value accessor method is used in order to synchronize the value of the model with the native control, or how happens the synchronization of disabled state. Again, all this stuff I cover in detail in my course about advanced Angular forms. Yes, we do a lot of source code investigation. So if you really want to join hundreds of developers who already know how this whole magic works, please welcome, links in the video description, check it out. So in such a way, we get a complete bridge design pattern implementation that allows us easily scale and introduce new custom value accessors for our custom controls that might be represented as some custom components or directives, and they will stay compatible with both types of forms, with reactive and template driven ones. All right guys, that's it. Thanks for watching. I hope this video was useful and insightful, and if so, please share this video with your colleagues and friends. And if you want to support what I'm doing, the easiest thing you can do is to hit thumbs up for this video and leave your thoughts in the comment section. If you are willing to support my channel by some small donation, you could use this QR code right here, or you could use the Super Thanks, but using Super Thanks you also support Google, so this QR code would be better. And the real win-win situation is considering one of my video courses. In such a way, you get some cool knowledge and I get some support that allows me to create more videos like that. Anyway, I wish you a productive week ahead. Stay safe and see you in the next video.